Hey guys, Muse Ninja Matt here. Today I'm going to be talking about the Royal Rumble 2019. There'll be spoilers, of course, for the event, and I'll chuck some timestamps down below for everything. So this is the first pay-per-view I've watched in a while. I haven't really been paying much attention to like Raw and SmackDown in the main roster, mainly just been watching NXT. But I love the Rumble, and I was intrigued, like, can they draw me back in to the main roster? So we had the pre-show, and we had some really good promos from people like Daniel Bryan, Samoa Joe, Alexa Bliss. I especially liked the Absolution promo, where it looked like there was some ease there because of the Rumble. However, this didn't really come into the match. And as I said, because I haven't watched in a while, the video packages catching people up on events that have happened, I actually found really useful for once. So our first match on the pre-show, we had Dawson and Rezar versus Rude and Gable. And this match just felt so random and thrown together. We had, of course, the cameraman who stacked it over straight away, and we were like, good start. This match was fine. I mean, nothing special really happened. It was over quite quickly. It was just sort of there. And Rude and Gable ended up picking up the win. Now, for the rest of the matches, I actually had predictions beforehand. With that match, it was so thrown together and happened, we didn't really put predictions down. So we had next Rusev versus Shinsuke for the US title, and I actually picked Rusev to win this one. It was at this point as well in the night, I noticed the layout and how the arena was done, because it was in a baseball stadium, I believe, but it meant that there was no like set and Titantron. They just sort of walked up the steps and out. And then later on in the night, I clicked onto the fact that they were doing these animations around, but then I'm like, well, that's just for the audience at home, and it's a bit jarring. Again, this match was okay. Shinsuke's new attire, it was the first time I'm seeing it, and I don't know how I feel about it. Watching this match, the one thing that really stood out for me is just how agile Rusev is. It's nuts every time I realise it. Shinsuke ended up winning and becoming the new champ, and there was the spot where Rusev accidentally bumps into Lana and she hurts her ankle, and that'll play later into the night. We had more video packages, and we had the breaking news that Cena had been taken out the Rumble and Braun had been put in. And watching some of the video packages, one thing that really stood out for me was the bro kick that Shane McMahon had taken and just how stiff it looked. Of course, as well, we got the highlights from NXT TakeOver, and I got chills just from watching the highlights alone. The NXT brand and their big pay-per-views are just incredible. And then we got the news that at halftime heat for the Super Bowl, there's going to be DIY and Adam Cole versus Aleister Black, Velveteen Dream, and Ricochet, which is just an incredible six-man tag. They did an advert as well later on in the night, which was just ripping on Maroon 5, where they were like, Maroon 5, why watch that when you can watch Halftime Heat? And I was just like, oh, shade. We then had what was honestly for me my match of the night, which was the Fatal 4-Way Cruiserweight title match. I had Buddy Murphy down to retain, and I adored this match from start to finish. I liked it because every kick and punch, it sounded impactful, it looked really impactful. Buddy Murphy, the amount of times he got spiked on top of his head and it looked like they were just aiming to destroy his neck. And it was just a fun and fast-paced match. Like, I loved it so much, and it just really got the crowd hyped. And Buddy Murphy ended up retaining. We had a Drew McIntyre promo as well, and I really enjoyed that because of how intense it was, and you can really see, like, how far Drew has come. Moving on to the main show, and we started with Becky versus Asuka, and I had actually picked Becky to win the title. I thought overall this match had really good pace of being slightly slower at the start, each woman kind of trying to figure out a strategy, and then it just ramped up from there. The big spot that really stood out for me was the swinging neck breaker off the apron, because it looked like they didn't get a full rotation, so it looked really brutal. And afterwards, we realized the ref was having to slow down his count because Becky wasn't kicking out quick enough. And it looked like Becky was just out of it. She just landed like on her head. But they went through with the match, back and forth, trading submissions, using each other's submissions. And when Becky actually ended up tapping out and Asuka retained, we were all shocked because it was a clean win for Asuka, which people weren't expecting. We then had Miz and Shane versus The Bar for the tag titles, and I actually had The Bar for this one. I was really struggling to understand this, to understand why The Miz would team up with Shane. I didn't think it was in Miz's character at all. People are saying it will be a long storyline where The Miz is actually just trying to get into the title picture and is trying to use Shane to help him do that. The whole match, we were just kind of laughing our heads off, to be honest. Of course, there's the huge joke now where people are like, well, Shane McMahon's the best wrestler in the world because he won the World Cup and all this kind of stuff. And there were just moments like when he was taking the swing and he's holding his t-shirt down, and it was just a bit like, you look ridiculous taking the move that way. But then of course the shocking ending of Shane hit that shooting star press and got the win, and now Miz and Shane are the tag champs, and we were all just like, what just happened? But we did enjoy the match. Like, even though we were kind of laughing, being like, this is ridiculous, we still enjoyed it. We then had Ronda versus Sasha, and I picked Ronda for this one. I really like Ronda's new gear. It's a bit more personalized to her. And I really liked Ronda's storytelling in this. You know, I liked the fact that she's like, you guys think I can't wrestle, or I'm gonna prove you wrong. I like the fact that she really sold the arm throughout. I think they just both did a really good job at telling the story they wanted to during this match. And it looked brutal, some of the submissions that Ronda was being put in. I swear she must be able to like dislocate her arm, or she must be double jointed or something. But yeah, Ronda ended up retaining. And it was a little odd afterwards because they kept drawing the ending out with both women leaving, and it looked like there was going to be a brawl, but then there just wasn't. I also popped a little bit because they had an advert for the 2K19 game, and Cultaholic had a mention, and I was just like, I know who that is. I watched them on YouTube. So then we had the Women's Royal Rumble match. This was probably my favourite match on the main card. Last year, the Women's Rumble was the saving grace for me at that pay-per-view, and it's very similar here. Like, this match, so good. I had Natalya as my pick to win, and I kind of thought that, because a lot of people thought it was random, I thought they might be building up to Natalya versus Ronda at Mania. So I'm just going to go through quick points of like what stood out to me, like moments that stood out to me, because obviously these matches are very long and a lot is happening in them. I kind of lost my mind at Liv Morgan because she's just the best. And when she got eliminated so quickly, I was just there, because everyone knows I'm a huge fan of Liv. And then she got eliminated and everyone just looked at me and started laughing, and I was like, what just happened? There were, especially earlier on in the match, there were a few spots that looked a little bit messy, but the only one that really stood out to me was when Mickey spun around to do the kick and just didn't connect whatsoever. People are always going to point out botches in matches, but a lot of the time I'm like, if they're adjusting to it, it doesn't really matter. And to a lot of casual fans, they won't even notice that something's gone wrong. Nikki Cross as well. She came down, and Nikki Cross is somebody that I'm fully aware of, but have never properly watched. And I adore her gimmick. She is so into what she's doing, and she's so fun to watch. I really liked Kairi Sane's elbow drop. I don't know what it is, just the connection of it. I was like, that move really stood out to me. We had the surprise of Maria entering, and there were like release rumors around her and Mike Bennett. So the fact she came down, I was quite shocked about. And we ended up having that really odd spot where she like teamed up with Alicia Fox, but then she started stamping on Alicia Fox's gear, like her hat and stuff, and Alicia lost it and just had a paddy in the ring. And I was just sat like, I'm really unsure as to what's going on right now. Of course, we ended up having a spot between Mandy Rose and Naomi, and I really enjoyed this because of the fact that like Naomi did her usual escaping elimination, getting back up, and then Mandy Rose eliminates her anyway, and Mandy Rose is there posing. I think why I really liked this match was because there was a lot going on, but it was all just these fun little moments. So stuff like Zelina Vega hiding under the ring because, you know, she was kind of like, oh, I don't want to be in this match yet, I'm going to wait. And then Hornswoggle appears and Hornswoggle chases her out of the place. That was awesome. I liked the fact that when Ruby Riott entered, the whole Riott squad's there and they're just pulling people out the ring and beating them down. I also really liked some of the back and forth between Casey and Ripley. Casey avoiding elimination where she sort of scooted across and then climbed up the ring post to come back in. She's really athletic and Ripley just looked dominant and so strong. We had the moment, of course, then where Lana's trying to come down to the ring, but her ankle hurts too much. She ends up getting attacked by Nia Jax and then Becky comes out and Becky's like, put me in this match. That moment everyone popped for. So with this event, I ended up going out to watch it at 11's bar. And the crowd in there was amazing. They were loud, they were vocal, they were really into the event. And Becky coming out, people were just so hyped for it. It really is just a testament to how over Becky is and how great she is with this character. We had some good back and forth as well between Alexa Bliss and Ember Moon, like these two incredibly talented women, and just seeing them interact, I loved it. The ending to this match just was amazing. It was, for me, one of these moments where I'm just blown away. The fact that it came down to Becky and Charlotte, and there's the history there, and Charlotte's laughing because Becky's knee is injured, and she's hopping along being like, I can go, just let me fight, let me fight. It was emotional, and it was just this mind-blowing and powerful ending, and I really enjoyed it. This is how you do a Royal Rumble match. This is how it should be booked. It was perfect from start to finish. It was great seeing so many NXT call-ups as well. Daniel Bryan versus AJ. Now, this is where the night for me started to just go downhill a bit. So from the promo package, I was like, okay, I really like Daniel's new heel persona. I like the angle of like AJ needs to be more aggressive and Vince was trying to push AJ to be more aggressive. I think the thing with this match is I'm very used to the pacing of these matches being it starts off slow and it gets more and more intense as it goes along. Like, AJ was busted open quite early on. We had the spot where AJ did the like moonsault off the barricade into an inverted DDT, which is awesome. He used to do it a lot more often in TNA. We don't really get to see it in WWE. But the thing with this, the crowd was totally burnt out from watching the Women's Rumble. You needed a cool down match here, not your WWE title match. There was even moments where I was like, oh, I think the sound's gone off. And then I was like, it's not even that, just no one is making a sound. The crowd was so quiet. You could even hear at one point Daniel Bryan just breathing because of how quiet everything was. Every time it looked like the momentum was building up, it just kind of fell flat and the match felt like it never really got going. And I was disappointed as well because I wanted to see more of a mean streak from AJ to fit in with the story, and that didn't happen. And then the ending, Eric Rowan came down and helped Daniel Bryan win. Again, we were sat just like, what just happened? Why did this happen? We then had Finn versus Brock, and I had Finn down to win this one. With the last match, I had Daniel Bryan to retain, by the way, forgot to say. So Finn versus Brock, it started out so good. Finn just goes on the attack, and this was a theme throughout the match. Finn just did not let up. Every chance he got, he was attacking Brock, which is what he should be doing. He shoved Brock into the announcer's table and injured Brock's midsection, and Brock really sold this. Like, Brock would go for a German and just fall to the ground because he was hurt. The match was back and forth and we were really getting into it and getting really hyped because we were like, oh, he's got the injured midsection, which means, you know, coup de grace, Finn will get the win. And Finn hits his finisher, goes for a pin, and then Brock just sort of kicks out, gets him in the Kimura lock, and Finn taps. And we were all just a bit like, I understand Brock would have to use a submission because of the fact that he's injured in the midsection, but it was a bit disappointing that Finn tapped to the first submission lock put on him. It felt like time constraints were just suddenly chucked on the match and it just sort of ended. But then this was made worse by the fact that Brock kept beating Finn down after the match, and we were saying, well, we could have just had a longer match. And when he was being beat down, we were waiting. We were like, someone's got to come out to help him, and they didn't. And we were wondering, like, what's this done for Finn? So finally, we are on to the Men's Royal Rumble match, and I had Drew McIntyre for this one. It was weird, because obviously the commentary team ended up being King JBL and Michael Cole, so it's a bit of a throwback. I really liked it as well, because when Elias was sat doing his gimmick and the Walk with Elias thing, Corey Graves was like, we've already been here like 4.5 hours. Like, why is he taking so much time? Because this was a really long event. This event was like 5 hours long, and it really was a bit difficult to kind of stay hyped for it. So there were a lot of surprises in this. Like, Jeff Jarrett was number two coming out. And I was like, this is nuts. This is like the founder of TNA, and he's now entering at number two in the Royal Rumble. And it was so fun having him and Elias there. Kurt Angle came back, but it was quite short-lived. He didn't have a lot to do in the Rumble. We had Johnny Gargano came out, which was awesome. The place again popped like mad when he entered, and he had quite a good showing in the Rumble. One moment a lot of people noticed was Samoa Joe actually went to run to Johnny in the corner, and he slipped on his towel, and you saw Johnny put the foot up, pause, and then Joe ran again and he kicked Joe. But I really liked it because Joe did the spot and then he kicked his towel out the ring, and he had that little smile on his face being like, yeah, I know guys, like you all saw. One of my favourite entrants was Curt Hawkins, because he came down and he was, you know, getting in the ring, kicking someone, sliding back out, and then he went under the ring to hide. And we had Titus ran out, did his little gimmick of being like, whoa, I don't want to slip again, and then he chased Kurt under the ring, and when they got in, Kurt eliminated him, and everyone was like, Kurt's got an elimination in the Royal Rumble, this is huge. And then he was eliminated by Joe, and I was actually gutted. I like Seth Rollins' attitude as well, because he got like his really silly elimination where it was the ring post elimination, and I like how Seth just stood there and sort of shrugged and started laughing and just carried on fighting. Mustafa Ali as well had a really good showing at this Rumble, and he was so fun to watch. Like, having one of the 205 Live guys just flying about the place during the Rumble was awesome. We had two moments as well of Kofi Kingston saving himself. One where he just rolled his ankles along the apron to get back in, and then one where, like, he landed and Woods had caught him, and then he sort of sprung up onto Woods' back so that they could both get into the ring. And during Xavier's entrance, with the little graphics, he actually had the up, up, down, down graphic, which I thought was cool. No Way Jose being in this match. He was the one this year where he's walking down, he does his whole gimmick, he gets in the ring, gets clotheslined out. And then what I loved was the fact that he was just there, like, what just happened? And then just got up and danced away. We started getting some really cool entrants then. So we had Pete Dunne turned up, and we had Aleister Black turned up. And Aleister Black as well is one of those guys, you watch him and you realise how fast and agile he is, even though he's like a big guy. He also hit a really sweet kick on Dean, and I actually liked how Dean sold it and went out, because it didn't look like Dean eliminated himself. It looked like he naturally fell over the ropes. There was a really good moment as well between Pete Dunne and Aleister Black, because Pete Dunne was doing, obviously, like, snapping people's fingers, and there was a bit where Aleister Black sort of sold that his finger was snapped out of place, and he just went like that and cracked it back in. Shelton Benjamin turned up in the Rumble, and I was just sat thinking, like, Shelton Benjamin needs a good singles push with a mid-card title, definitely. I like as well the feud of Mustafa Ali and Samoa Joe. I just think that would be one of those feuds that I wouldn't get tired of watching. There was a moment as well, I'm not entirely certain, but it looked like Almas at one point literally went over to Rey Mysterio and was like, are you okay? Checking on him. And it just so happened that the camera landed on them at that point in time, but I can't be sure. There was a lot of debate as well about Bobby Lashley when he got eliminated because of how quick it was. Was that meant to happen or did he slip off the ropes? So then we come towards the end of the match and all of us were like, R-Truth is not being in this match. He's announced as number 30, but something will happen. And people were like, who will enter at number 30? This is exciting. And R-Truth comes out and Nia Jax attacked him. So we were like, yes, he's not being in the match. But then Nia started walking down and people were getting a little bit angry because they were like, the number 30 spot should be a big surprise. And instead it's Nia. She came out and, you know, she did like the shoulder tackle to Randy Orton. She ended up taking a super kick and a 619 and an RKO. And I was really curious as to what the intention behind this was. A few people have said about Nia has injured people recently. And I was like, is this some kind of punishment for her? But apparently it was just to introduce the idea that the men and women are probably just going to start having more matches together. When it came down to it, and it came down to Seth and Braun, I was a little bit disappointed. Just because I really felt like, we've been here, we've done this. It would have been nice to have somebody new and unexpected win. I know we had Shinsuke win last year, but like I would have taken Dolph winning or Almas winning. I think realistically, most people said they'd rather see Seth AJ and have Brock do something different. But yeah, I really loved the women's title matches, the women's rumble, the Cruiserweight Fatal 4-Way match. Basically, all the way up until Daniel Bryan AJ, I was having a good time with the pay-per-view, apart from maybe the weird tag match on the pre-show. That was just random. But then it was almost like everyone was just so exhausted from going nuts at the Women's Rumble that it kind of lost steam. And sometimes the way the crowd is feeling can really affect the atmosphere of the match. Like the Men's Rumble was okay, don't get me wrong. Some of the call-ups, returns, moments were really good. I mean, with this, I had fun watching this pay-per-view. And at the end of it, I thought, do you know what? Well done, WWE. Because that's how I should feel when I'm watching my wrestling. Even if there are decisions where I'm going, why did they do that? I should just enjoy watching the product and be like, okay, I want to keep watching because I want to know where this is going, what their plans are. And this is a fun time for that because it's the road to WrestleMania. I'll have to see if I tune in with Elimination Chamber. I'll definitely watch WrestleMania, but with Elimination Chamber, it's all about the participants. They kind of make or break the pay-per-view for me. And yeah, had such a good time watching this event at 11's bar because the atmosphere was great and everyone there was chanting and screaming and just really got into it. And when you're around so many passionate wrestling fans, it really does make the event more special. Anyway, guys, thank you so much for watching. This video has been a very long one. Don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe as it really helps the channel out. Check out the links in the description down below. Check out the whole channel, especially the playlists. And I will see all of you in the next one.